सर। ओके सर। सर चिल्ड्रन సార్ బ్లూటూత్ కనెక్ట్ అయిందని వచ్చేసుకోండి। దీంట్లో లింక్ పంపించిన సౌండ్ విన వస్తుంది లేదు, ఇంకా పంపిలేదు। ఆడియో ఆడియో వస్తుంది లేదు, దీని క్లాస్ స్టార్ట్ అయినాక क्वालिटी सर। Good morning, students. So yesterday ended with the total internal reflection and lenses concept. Okay. So now we'll go for prisms, children. See here. Prism. So if this is the triangular cross section of the prism, ABC. A is the angle of prism, children, and these are the two normals. And if this is the incident ray, this is the refracted ray, and this is emergent ray, and this is angle of incidence, children, and this is angle of emergence. Okay, children, and extend these two rays. So this is angle of refraction at first surface, angle of refraction at second surface, children. And if you extend this, this is angle of deviation for first surface, this is angle of deviation for second surface, and this angle is total deviation. So total deviation is how much, children? D1 plus D2. And we have a D1 is equals to I1 minus R1 and D2 equals to I2 minus R2, children. Very useful formulas. And here we have a angle of prism or a refracting angle. Okay, two names are there, don't confuse. Refracting angle is also known as angle of prism. So A equals to R1 plus R2. Right, children? And we have I1 plus I2 equals to A plus D. This is also very, very important, children. I1 plus I2 equals to A plus D. Okay? And when prism is in minimum deviation, when prism is in minimum deviation, children, means we have a graph, ID graph, angle of deviation and angle of incidence. If angle of incidence increases, angle of deviation decreases, reaches a minimum value and again increases. Right, children? So this is minimum deviation, children, delta. Here what happens, you know, I1 becomes equals to R2, which is very, very important. When prism is in minimum deviation, angle of incidence is equals to angle of emergence. Very, very important. I1 equals to R2, R1 is equals to R2, then what happens? A equals to 2R, R equals to A by 2. Similarly, if you want I plus I equals to A plus delta, you will get. So I is equals to A plus delta by 2, you will get. Now, refractive index of the material of the prism is given by N is equals to sin A plus delta by 2 divided by sin A by 2. Sin A plus delta by 2 by sin A by 2, children. Okay, na? When it is, when prism is in air, when prism is in air, this is material, okay, divided by N surroundings. If the surroundings is any liquid, then in any liquid, very, very important, then what happens? Ng divided by NL is equals to sin A plus delta by 2 by sin A by 2. Right, children? And here you should remember that in any question, if normal incidence is given, normal incidence, normal incidence or normal emergence is given, means like this. This is normal, but in this direction only ray is entering. What happens? The ray enters in the same path only, na? Enters in the same path, and here what happens? Refraction occurs. So here angle of incidence becomes 90 degrees. Sorry, angle of incidence becomes 0 degrees, remember. Yes or no? Because it is passing through the normal, so there is no angle from normal. So angle of incidence is 0 degrees, remember.
normal emergence is given. Normal emergence is angle of emergence is 0. And grazing is given. Grazing, very important. Grazing. Grazing incidence. Whenever the light is grazing children, the angle in the denser medium is a critical angle, remember. Okay, now whenever the ray is grazing the surface means the angle in the denser medium is a critical angle only. See here, if this is prism, if that is prism, we know this is normals. The ray is like this, it is entering means through the surface, on the surface, grazing. Then angle of incidence is 90 degrees, remember. Angle of incidence is 90 and the angle in the denser medium is a critical angle. For example, the ray is grazing again here. Emergence also grazing. Okay, children. So, extend it. So, this is also critical angle. This is also critical angle, remember. R1 is also C. R2 is also C. Then what happens? A equals to R1 plus R2. So, we have A equals to 2C, children. Okay. So, like this. Normal incidence is given I10, normal emergence is given I20, grazing incidence is given I190, grazing emergence is given I290, and whenever grazing concept is there, this angle in the denser medium is almost equal to critical angle. Okay, so the maximum value of angle of prism to get an emergent ray is 2C. If A equal to 2C, you will have emergent ray. If A is greater than 2C, there is no emergence. There is a total internal reflection takes place, which is very, very important, children. Okay. See here. If angle of incidence, I will draw this diagram again, which is most important. So, grazing incidence and grazing emergence. See, children. Okay, now like this if it is. So, this is normal, children. This is also normal. The ray is entering like this, children. Grazing means. Okay, now. So, this is I1 is 90. Okay, now. Okay, if it is refracting like this. Again, the grazing emergence it is. So, this is also 90. I2 also 90. And if we extend this. This is what, children? Angle of refraction. Whenever grazing takes place, this is denser medium, you know, this is air, this is denser medium, this angle is critical angle, this angle also, grazing, na? Angle in the denser medium is critical angle only. We have A equals to C plus C, so A equals to 2C. If A is less than or equals to 2C, emergent ray will come. If A is greater than 2C, total internal reflection takes place, remember. Okay, now. So, the same condition is written in another way in terms of refractive index also. If A is greater than 2C, what happens? The ray undergoes total internal reflection. So, if A greater than 2C, or refractive index is greater than cosecant A by 2. Same, this is only rearranged like this. Then what happens? Total internal reflection takes place. Total internal reflection takes place, children. Okay.
Next concept, children. So after this prism, we have actually optical instruments. Optical instruments. After that, I will start wave optics, children. Okay, na? Optical instruments. And we have one more concept also. If lens is cut, what happens? Okay, see here. One question they are asking. Cutting off lens, which is very, very important. If this is the lens, if you cut like this, or if you cut like this, okay, children, this is longitudinal, this is transverse. If the lens is cut like this, what happens, you know, children? The focal length doubles each piece, okay? See here. So, this is actually lens. Its focal length is f. If you cut like this, each part focal length remains same only, children. Remember, this is also f, this is also f. Why? Because in this there is no change in the material, and radius of curvature is also not changing. If the lens is cut along the principal axis, what is the lens maker's formula? We have 1 by f is equals to n minus 1 into 1 by r1 plus 1 by r2 for biconvex lens. R1, r2 will not change, n will not change, so f remains same, f and f only. But if you take like this, if you cut the lens perpendicular to principal axis, then what happens? Radius of curvature becomes changing. Yes or no, children? So radius of curvature changes. That's for focal length also changes. So for each piece, it is a double 2f. For this also, how much, children? It is 2f. And now it becomes what? Plano-convex lenses. Two plano-convex lenses. Such combination is used in microscopes and telescopes, children. Okay, to avoid errors in the images. So now, little time I will explain optical instruments, children. So optical instruments is very, very, very important. Simple microscope. Simple microscope, children. So it can, what is simple microscope? It is nothing but normal magnifying lens to see the smaller objects bigger, we are using already. So that is called what? Simple microscope. See here. So this is the lens. It contains only single lens, children. And this is the optic center, O dash. And this is what? Focus. And here I will take object. This is object O, children, OJ or something. Okay, na? So, where object is placed? Object is placed just behind the, means just inside, within the principal focus. Means, if object is placed between focus and optic center, what happens? Image is formed on the same side only. Very important here. If the object is placed between focus and optic center, image is formed on the same side only. Means here object is there, this side only. And this is object distance u. So one light ray passes like this. Other light ray passes like this. If you extend this, if you extend these rays, you will get image here. So, this image is formed at a distance of what? D. D means what? Distance, least distance of distinct vision, 25 centimeters.
right children? So this is nothing but V. This is nothing but V. V is equals to D, right children? So here we have some formulas, magnifying powers, magnifying power. So M is equals to image distance by object distance. Image distance by object distance. Right children, this is more normal simple microscope. And if you want in terms of focal length, then M infinity equals to D by F is their formula. M near point is 1 plus D by F, very very important. If the image is formed at infinity, what is the magnification power? D by F. If the image is formed at near point, means at 25 centimeters, this is the formula, and D they will give. D is how much? 25 centimeters. Right children? If you want in terms of power, it is dp, power. And magnifying power is inversely proportional to focal length, remember. Previous question it is. Right children? And next, we'll go for compound microscope. Compound microscope. So compound microscope is used for what? This is also for magnification purpose. So this is also used for what children? Magnification purpose only. But two lenses are there here. Two lenses are used. See here. This is objective lens, which is placed near the object. Optic center. This is F. 2F. Here also F. 2F. Now here object is placed just outside the focus. Like this. Right children? So one light ray like this. And another light ray I will take like this. So real image is formed. Real inverted image is formed. Real inverted image and magnified image. See, I'll take this is OJ. And this is I1, G1 is image. Intermediate image. This is not final image. This length becomes increased. Okay. Okay, na? And this is object distance. U0. Because for objective lens. This is image distance. Okay, children? Image distance, V0. Now it acts as object for eyepiece. One more lens is there. That is what, children? Eyepiece, which is having a larger diameter and larger focal length. Very, very important. So this is objective lens, this is what? Eyepiece. And its optic center I will take as O double dash. Now what happens? This image acts as object for this lens. And again you will get image. This is the focal length of eyepiece for this focal length. Okay children? Now, if you extend this, you will get image. I don't have place here. I am drawing here, right children? Just extend it. At what distance you will get here? D. Right children? At a distance D, you will get image. Okay. So, now, this is UE. Means what? Object distance. This is object for that, na? That's why. This is final image. IG. IG, final image. If only one lens is there, M is the magnification. Two lenses are there, na? So product of their individual magnifications, this is also important. Overall magnification is nothing but two lenses, M1 into M2. So M is equals to MO, objective magnification, ME, eyepiece magnification. So this is equals to image distance by object distance, image distance by object distance, two lenses, right children? And in terms of focal length, we have one more formula, that is equals to V naught by U naught into 1 plus D by F E. Right children? Because this lens and this roll is same here, okay? This is the actual formula. And if you rearrange, see, these lenses distance is there, you know, that is called L, length of the compound microscope. The distance between the two lenses is called what? Length of the compound microscope. So now we have another formula. M is equals to minus LD divided by F naught into FE after arranging. Okay. Then how M relates with focal length? F proportional to 1 by F naught FE. Means what? If you want magnification power more, then focal length should be less. Less children here. In the case of what? In the case of compound microscope. Okay. So next, telescope is there children. Astronomical telescope. Maximum questions they are asking from that. Astronomical telescope. Okay. So, M is equals to minus LD by F naught FE, or M is proportional to what children? 1 by F naught FE. This remember. So, now astronomical telescope. Astronomical telescope. What is the purpose, children, astronomical telescope? To see the distant objects in the sky. To see the distant objects in the sky, we are using astronomical telescope. And we know that in space, in sky, maximum all the objects are spherical in shape. Though image is inverted also, nothing will happen. See, why this negative sign indicates, you know, the final image is inverted. See here. The final image is, arrow mark is down, you know. Final image is inverted, negative sign indicates. Okay. In astronomical telescope also, final image is inverted, but no problem. If a spherical ball becomes inverted also, appears sphere only. So, what is the use of astronomical telescope? To see the distant objects nearer. But one important point is there. In astronomical telescope, the objective lens should be larger in size, unlike compound microscope. In compound microscope, objective lens is smaller, eyepiece is larger. But in telescope, objective lens is larger. Why? Objects are very far. The lens has to gather more amount of light. That's why size should be more. Not only for that, children, to have better resolution. If two stars we are observing, some children will say, no, it appears as one star only, but some persons may tell, no, two stars. So, their eyes unable to separate the two nearest stars. So, what we have to do? We have to see through the telescope. It should resolve. To have better resolution, objective lens diameter should be very large. Very, very important point. Okay? So, see here, astronomical telescope. How many lenses here? Here also, two lenses are required. One lens is a big lens. This is objective lens. Right, children? So, now, from where the light rays will come from distant object na, how they will come parallelly, because object is at infinity stars. So these are the light rays children. Okay children, so this is image I1 G1. So these are the rays from distant star. Okay children, means if the object is at infinity, where image will form? At near point, sorry, at principal focus. So this distance is f naught, exactly at focus means focal length. So now we want another lens, yes or no, to get a good resolution, etc., good angular magnification. Second lens called eyepiece, which is smaller diameter, smaller focal length, like this. Right children? Okay na? So the second lens is eyepiece. This is called eyepiece. Optic center of that lens. Now here children, one more thing. We want to see the distant objects. Appears nearer. Nearer okay, but not very nearer children. Why? Because if you want to read, if you place your book very nearer, we can't see that. Eye will take strain. Yes or no? That's why better to get the image at infinity. The final image better to form at infinity means some distance. Infinity means here. Then when image will form at infinity? If object is at its focus, yes or no? That's why if you adjust the position of the eyepiece such that, okay, the image due to the objective lens should forms at the eyepiece focus, thereby final image will forms at infinity. We can see without strain, relaxed eye, it is called. So this is, okay children, I will write here, see, this point is focus for objective lens and focus for eyepiece also, remember. Okay na? So now like this you will get, see, these are parallel rays. Okay, here your eye is there, so the rays will reach your eye and it is inverted image only, and this distance is FE, focal length. Now what is the distance between the two lenses? L is equals to, very important children, very very important, L is equals to F naught plus FE. And magnification power formula, M is equals to minus F naught by FE. While using formulas and numericals, don't take negative sign. F naught by FE is enough. Because why negative sign? Final image is inverted. And where final image is formed as per this diagram? Where it is? Yes, it is at infinity. If you want the final image at near point, then if image is formed at near point means what children? At 25 centimeters from your eye, 25 centimeters. Then formulas will change. L is equals to F naught plus UE will come. Okay. And M also will change. Minus F naught by UE will come. Right children, then how can you find UE? By using lens equation. So what is the lens equation? 1 by F is equals to 1 by V minus 1 by U is a lens equation. Very very important children. So Lenz equation is there. Lenz equation. 1 by F is equals to 1 by V minus 1 by U. By using that, you can get a UE value. Right, children? I will write here. 1 by UE equals to, you will get 1 by D plus 1 by FE, children. Because sign convention you have to use, na? Convex lenses are there. Focal length is always positive. Okay, but image distance, object distance, sign you have to consider. Right, children? So, with this ray optics and optical instruments is over, children. And now I will go for wave optics. Okay, children? Everything is visible, children. F naught plus UE. Okay. Here, I think this is not visible. So, L is equals to F naught plus UE, children. And M is equals to minus F naught by UE. And this also, Lenz equation. Lenz equation is 1 by F is equals to 1 by V minus 1 by U. Right, children? So now I will start wave optics, children. I will rub this part, okay? And here, children, they are asking this question. See here. To have good resolving power, to have good resolving power, focal length should be what? Larger. Focal length of objective length should be larger, remember. Focal length also larger. And see here, size, diameter or aperture is also larger, remember. And this magnification is directly proportional to focal length of objective lens and inversely proportional to focal length of eyepiece, remember. Okay, children. So now wave optics. In this, the first concept we have to deal is interference. Interference, children. Okay, so before this you should know already the concept of wave front. The locus of all the points which are vibrating in the same phase is called what, children? Wave front. Means between any two points on the same wave front, phase difference is how much? Zero, children. Phase difference is zero between any two points in the wave front. Okay, and if the two waves have same amplitude, same wavelength, same frequency and constant phase difference, they are said to be coherent. Right, children? Coherent waves. The source which sends the coherent waves are called coherent sources. But unfortunately, all these natural sources of light are not coherent. They are incoherent sources because their phase rapidly changes. So what is phase? Just look at a glance here. See here, this is one wave. Here phase how much? Zero. Here phase how much? 90. Here 180. Here 270. Here how much? 360. This is the phase. Now I will take two waves. Two waves. This is one wave. This is one wave. Two waves are there. for these two waves, what is the phase here? 0, 0. So difference how much? 0 minus 0, 0. 180 minus 180 is 0. 270 minus 270 is 0. Okay. So here, how much is the phase difference? 0. But another case is there. Another case. Right, children? Like this. So here it is 0. For this it is 180. Here it is 90. For this it is 270. So what is the difference here? They are not in phase, but constant phase. Constant phase. 180 minus 0, 180. 270 minus 90, 180. So phase difference how much here? 180. That is constant only. Right, children? So now, if I will draw another case, see here, another case. This is one wave, children. This is first wave. Okay? And this is another wave. If these two waves combine, what happens? Phase difference changes very fast. Such waves are not coherent. So, these waves are incoherent. These waves are called what, children? Incoherent waves. Otherwise, they are called coherent waves. Okay, children, following? So, there are three types of wavefronts, children. Very, very important. Three types of wavefronts are there. So, that is spherical wavefront, cylindrical wavefront, and plane wavefront, which is very, very important.
There are three types of wavefronts, children. Very, very important.
Okay. Now, what are the three types of wavefronts? Shapes are there. Depending upon the position, three types are there. Nearest point source is there. Nearest point source, spherical wavefronts will come. Nearest linear sources are the linear sources, cylindrical wavefronts. If they are at infinity, distant sources are there, plane wavefront, very important. Okay, na? So first I will go for what? Interference. Without a question from interference and diffraction, there is no question paper, children. Very important. See, how much is possible, I will explain, children. So, remaining I will send in the written form. So, please practice that. So, interference. See, children, very important. Okay, no? I will take two slits, S1, S2. This is screen. This is what? Screen. From here, one light ray. From here, another light ray. Right, children? Two waves are meeting. Crust. When crust falls on crust, constructive interference, intensity maximum. When crust falls on trough, destructive interference, intensity becomes minimum. So, first wave equation, y1 equals to a1 sin omega t. Second wave, a2 sin omega t plus phi. Phi is phase difference. Then resultant amplitude is given by, very, very important, resultant amplitude. So parallelogram law, A equals to under root A1 square plus A2 square plus 2A1 A2 cos phi. Right, children? So this is the resultant amplitude, children. So if phi is equals to 0 degrees, Okay, then what happens, children? AR equals to A1 plus A2, that is equals to maximum. Maximum. Okay. Now, if you want intensity, if you want intensity, very, 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 very important. Intensity is directly proportional to square of the amplitude, remember. Intensity is directly proportional to square of the amplitude. So, if you want maximum, resultant intensity, square this, children, square this, what you will get? A1 square plus A2 square plus 2A1 A2 cos phi you will get. Yes or no? This is in terms of your amplitudes. So, wherever A square is there, put I. Wherever A square is there, put I. So, IR is equals to I1 plus I2 plus, see, A square is there, I. A is there, root I will come. So, 2 root I1, I2 cos phi. Very, very important. Okay, na? Now, if you want I max, A1 plus A2 whole square will come. Because A max is A1 plus A2, I max is A1 plus A2 whole square. Or one more formula, I max equals to root I1 plus root I2 whole square. Yes or no? Now, next another. If phase is equals to 180 degrees, if phase difference is 180, destructive interference, minimum intensity, minimum amplitude. So, amplitude is minimum A1 minus A2. Intensity minimum equals to what? A1 minus A2 whole square. Right, children? So, ratio I max by I min. If you see the previous question papers of CET, NEET, JEE, so many times repeated, what is the ratio of maximum intensity to minimum intensity? The formula is A1 plus A2 divided by A1 minus A2 whole square. If you know A1, A2, if you know I1, I2, then root I1 plus root I2 divided by root I1 minus root I2 whole square. Okay, children, for example, ratio of intensities is 4:1. Ratio of intensities is 4:1. Find the Imax to Imin. Find Imax to Imin. Okay, now how? Answer, see here. What is given? I1 by I2 is given. 4:1. Sometimes they will ask amplitudes ratio also. Amplitudes ratio. A1 by A2 equals to what, children? Root I1 by I2. So, how much will come? 2:1. Now, Imax by Imin. Imax by Imin. What is Imax by Imin formula? A1 plus A2 by A1 minus A2 whole square. Okay? So, this is equals to 2 plus 1 by 2 minus 1. So, how much will come, children? 9:1, which is very, very important, children. So, 2 plus 1 by 2 minus 1. So, 3 square by 1 square. So, you will get what? 9:1. I will write here. It's not visible. Amplitude ratio is 4:1. Okay, children. So, this is equals to 2 plus 1 by 2 minus 1 whole square. That is equals to what? 9:1. This is one model. Okay, children. So, next, if amplitudes are same or intensities are same, then what is the resultant intensity? Very, very important, children. Resultant intensity. If A1 is equals to A2, See here, children. If I1 is equals to I2, I will take it as I0. Then we have resultant intensity equals to 4I0 cos square 5/2, children. Very, very important. Remember, if I1 is equals to I2 is equals to I0, means these two waves have same intensity. This is the formula. If you want amplitude, amplitude means what? Root I, na? So A equals to what? 2. Root I naught is A naught. Square cancel. So what will come? This will come. This is for amplitude. That is for intensity. But maximum they are asking intensity. 4 I naught cos square 5/2. Right, children? So now we will go for very, 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 very important Young's double slit experiment. Young's double slit experiment and fringe width. Young's double slit experiment and fringe width. So, Young's double slit experiment and fringe width. Right, children? See here. Two slits I will take. S1, S2. The distance between the two slits is D, I will take. At some distance, I will keep one screen. This is what, children? Screen. Two light rays will come from S1 and S2. Right, children? Which light ray travels more distance? This light ray. So, there is a difference in the paths. Right, children? So, if you draw a normal here, take it as N. This is extra. If these two are equal, I will take this point as P. This is extra distance traveled called path difference. What is that, children? Path difference. And I will take here theta. Now one thing, see, children. This is screen. From S1, from S2, if two light rays travels such that if the distances are equal, means here to here, here to here, same distance traveled by the two light rays, na? So there is no phase difference, na? There is no path difference, na? Intensity is maximum. This is the center of the screen called central maxima. What is that, children? Central maxima. Very, very, very important, children. Central maxima. There is no phase difference, there is no path difference here. And this distance is taken as y. Some will take x, some will take y, no problem. I will take as y, and path difference I will take as what, children? X. Okay, children. And what is the intensity formula, children? In general, intensity formula is 4I0 cos square 5/2. Yes, sir. So maximum intensity, minimum intensity we want. If this phase difference is there, you know, for what values of phi? This is maximum, that I also maximum, na? So first of all, 0, cos 0, yes or no? 1 into 4I naught, and 2 pi, 4 pi, and so on, 2n pi. What happens, you know, children? Intensity is maximum. For maxima, it is. What is the difference between, relation between phase difference and path difference? phi is equals to 2 pi by lambda into x. We have this relation. From that, you will get x is equals to 0, first 0, lambda, 2 lambda, and so on, n lambda. Very important. If phase if path difference is lambda, constructive interference maximum will come. If path difference is 10 lambda, same 11 lambda, 12 lambda, 13 lambda, n lambda, constructive interference. So, intensity maximum. That Imax formula is what, children? 4I0. For all these points, you will get bright region on the screen. You will get dark regions also. Actually, what is interference pattern? Alternately, bright, dark. Bright, dark you will see. For all these, you will get bright, 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 brighter. All brights, but one bright is special. What is that brighter? Zero. Means at center. Here, phi zero, x also what? Zero only. That's why it is called central maxima. Next, minima we will check. Minima. For minima, intensity should be zero. Means dark, it is dark. I should be, if it is zero, perfectly dark bright you can see. Okay, no? So when it is, when phi is equals to pi, put pi here, pi by 2, 90, cos 90 is 0 only. And the next 3 pi, 5 pi, and so on, 2n minus 1 into pi. Some books they gave plus here. If you take plus also, correct only, but exact answers will come for minus, remember. Take minus. Now path difference is very important, children. Lambda by 2. 3 lambda by 2, 5 lambda by 2, and so on. 2n minus 1 into lambda by 2. So, for all these, you will get a minimum intensity. So, like that, on the screen, you will get a central maxima, first maxima, second maxima. Below also, you will get first maxima, second maxima, third maxima, like that. So, I will take this is a central maxima. What is this, children? First minima. This is a first maxima. Again, this is second minima. This is second maxima. Yes or no? Like that, the distance between any two successive bright fringes or dark fringes is called fringe width. See. This is first bright, this is second bright. Na? This distance is called fringe width, beta. Same, minimas also, minima, dark, dark. This is also what? Beta, fringe width it is. So, there is a formula for fringe width, children. Very important, fringe width. Fringe width beta equals to lambda d by d. Remember, fringe width beta equals to lambda d by d. If yellow color is replaced by blue color, what happens to fringe width? Decreases. Why? See, beta proportional to lambda. Wavelength increases, fringe width also increases. No? Yes or no? Now, if the total arrangement, this arrangement, without disturbing the slits screen, and here see, what is capital D? Capital D is the distance between slits on the screen. Small d is the distance between the two slits. If what is our concept now, without disturbing the setup, if you immerse in liquid or water, then what happens? Changes, children. This gaps is there, you know, this beta value changes. So, in any medium, so beta medium is equals to beta by n, very important, beta by n, right children? So, n is what? Refractive index. Now, see here, y is there, y is linear, linear distance. If you want angular distance like this, this is theta. Here one fringe, here one fringe. So this is called what? Angular separation. This is called what? Linear separation. Very, very important, children. The most useful formula in wave optics, I am writing now. Most useful formula. Most useful formula. Any distance on the screen they will ask. Any distance, formula remember, y is equals to x d by d. From this only you will get sin theta equals to x by d, tan theta equals to y by d. Equate, you will get for small angles, sin theta, cos theta, same you know. Okay, children, this is the formula. But what they will ask, bright fringe, dark fringe, x value changes. For bright, if they will ask any question is bright, then y becomes n lambda d by d, most important formula. Distance of fifth bright is asked, distance of fifth bright from central maxima, this distance, okay na, 5 lambda d by d, 10th bright, 10 lambda d by d. Now dark is asked. For dark, okay children, so y is equals to 2n minus 1 into lambda d by d. Why children, see here, for dark fringes x value is this one, 2n minus 1 into lambda by 2. In the place of x we are writing this. Sixth dark, sixth don't plus use here, minus use. Sixth dark, 2 into 6, 12 minus 1, 11, 11 lambda d by 2d. So very, very important, children. Okay, na? So linear distance is beta, angular distance is theta. Angular distance, see, angular distance y by d. Remember. Okay, so I will do some formulas on angular width also, children. Right. Fraction kuda unde. Right, children. Question number 10. So I will do one question here. There is a concept called fringe visibility. Fringe visibility. V. Fringe visibility means the best interference pattern is nothing but, if you see at the screen, it appears perfectly bright, perfectly dark, separately, contrast should be there. Then it is called good visibility. How you can measure? There is a formula, very important, 3 to 4 times came in the exam also. V equals to I max minus I min divided by I max plus I min. Remember, this is the formula, children. Okay, now sometimes they will ask what is fringe visibility formula. From this you will get. Sometimes they will ask what is this value. So you should know the formulas, children. Okay, now so what is I max, children? Root I1 plus root I2. Yes or no? This root I max, root I1 plus root I2 whole square minus root I1 I minimum. Remember, just now I explained, na? Root I1 minus root I2 whole square. divided by addition children. Root I1 plus root I2 whole square plus root I1 plus root I2 whole square minus. So V equals to A plus B whole square minus A minus B whole square is what children? 4AB. So you will get 4 root I1 I2. Okay, yes sir, no. A plus B whole square minus A minus B whole square is what? 4AB. And here A plus B whole square plus A minus B whole square, you will get what? 2 into A square plus B square. A square plus B square plus 2AB. A square plus B square minus 2AB. Okay, children. So, what you will get now? Any formula here? So, 2 into I1 plus I2 you will get. Because 2 into A square plus B square. So now, given, in the question what they are given is, intensity ratio they are giving children, beta. 2 1s are, 2 2s are. Intensity ratio they are giving beta. If you rearrange, you will get 2 root beta by 1 plus beta. Because there are some options, 2 root beta by 1 plus beta, 2 root beta by beta square plus 1, 4 options are there. So, you do children, 2 root beta by 1 plus beta. Mathematically you solve, but this question is very very important. Mathematically, if you take here I2 outside, I2 outside, okay na, you will get 1 plus I1 by I2. I1 by I2 is how much? Beta. Right children? So, next question. Next question children, question number 2, in Young's double slit experiment, wavelength is given, wavelength 400 nanometers, nano means 10 power minus 9, okay, the angular width for first minima, angular width is given. Angular width. Theta children. How much it is? 0.2 degree. Angular width. Okay, na? 0.2 degree. Now, this arrangement is immersed in water. Then what happens to angular fringe width? If arrangement is immersed in water, refractive index is given, then new angular width how much? This is our question. Okay children, now see here. Beta I gave already. Okay, now see here. Beta water is equals to beta by n water. Beta by n children. Beta in air, in water it becomes y. Decreases fringe width. Same here. Same. Theta water is equals to theta by n water. Because if angle increases, that line, that distance also increases only. Now both are directly proportional. Same formula you can use. So theta is given 0.2 by 4 by 3. So how much you will get children? Any option? 0.15 will come. See how easy it is. 0.15. Next. Third question. Okay, children. So here, this is also belongs to in Young's double slit experiment. Here, the relation is in between angular fringe width and slit separation. Slit separation means small d. D1 is 2 mm, children. Initially, distance between two slits is 2 mm. At that time, angular fringe width is given 0.20 degree. 0.20 degree. To make angular fringe width 0.21 degree, then d2 equals to how much? This is the question. So you should know the relation. What is the relation between theta and small d? See here. Theta equals to beta by d, children, remember. How? Theta equal to arc by radius. Yes or no? See here. This is theta. This is taken as arc. This is d. You know, this is screen. Fringe width how much, children? Beta. Fringe width is beta. Screen it is. This is, we know this. Theta equals to tan theta beta by d. So, beta formula I gave already, lambda d by d into d. Right, children? Dd cancel. So, what you will get? Theta equals to lambda by d. So, theta is inversely proportional to d. For theta, so many formulas are there. This is the formula here we have to use. So, theta and d are inversely related. Then, easy formulas are there now. Inversely related means theta 1 by theta 2 equals to d2 by d1. Use this formula, children, okay na? Use this formula. I will go for the another question. Next. Okay, easy questions are there. Next, most important question. Right, children? Children, what is the formula for bright fringe distance, children? We have bright fringe distance. Bright fringe distance. Y is equals to n lambda d by d. What is y, children? What is y? Distance on the screen. If it is constant, y, d, comma d are constants, then n1 lambda 1 equals to n2 lambda 2. Remember, very, very important formula. N1 lambda 1 equals to N2 lambda 2. How they will ask questions is, in Young's double slit experiment, the experiment is done two times. First with one wavelength, another with another wavelength. The two wavelengths are given. Lambda 1 is given 12,000 angstroms. Lambda 2 also given 10,000 angstroms. Okay, see here, like this, you know, right, children? This is y, or this is also you can take as y, total separation. Up to here, total fringes are there. In the same separation only, fringes came for two wavelengths. One time with 12,000, in that portion only fringes are there. Second time with 10,000 also, in the same portion fringes are there. Then you know what happens, children? the bright fringe of first wavelength may coincide with any bright fringe of second wavelength. So recall the concept of vernier calipers. What is vernier calipers? N divisions on main scale, sorry, vernier scale coincides with N minus 1 divisions on main scale. 10 divisions on vernier scale coincides with 9 divisions on main scale. But only one will coincide. That is called vernier coincidence. Here also same, children. That you have to find here. Okay, children. So, which fringe coincide? What is the distance, they will ask. Fourth fringe, fifth fringe, like that. Now see here. N1, N2 we want. N1 into 12,000 equals to N2 into 10,000. So actually what they are asking? Find. Right, children? The distance from central maxima, find distance from central maxima where bright fringe of first lambda coincides with second. That is the question, children. Okay, na? So you have to find the distance first. 3 zeros cancel, 3 zeros cancel. 12N1 equals to 10N2. 6N1 equals to 5N2. N1 by N2 equals to what, children? 5 by 6. So remember it. Now, very simple. Fifth bright fringe of lambda 1 coincides with the sixth bright fringe of lambda 2. Fifth coincides with the sixth. But distance also they are asking, you know. Distance they are asking. So many times this question came, children. Actually, this question is in your NCERT textbook also. So now distance. Y is equals to. Actually, two answers will come in. Same answers only will come. 5 take for lambda 1, 6 take for lambda 2. So 5 first lambda 1 d by d. Or y is equals to 6 lambda 2 d by d. Anything. Because answer you will get same. Why? Because 12,000 into 5, 60,000. 6 into 10,000, 60,000. DD are same only. So try, children, you will get one answer. Okay, na? So this is the concept. Any question coincide is there, this is the method. First to find N1 N2 and do and use N1 lambda 1 D by D or N2 lambda 2 D by D. Okay, children. Right. So next. So another concept is also pending is there, children. I have only 8 minutes now. So diffraction I have to explain. So for diffraction also you are getting so many questions, which is very, very important, children. So maximum I will cover some formulas in diffraction now. Okay. So evening I will send numericals, children. Okay. So what is this? Shall I have this portion, children? This is very, very important model. Okay. and diffraction interference are nearly same children. Similar formulas are there. So you know what is diffraction, children? The bending of light at the edges of an obstacle and enters into geometrical region of shadow. That is what diffraction. See here. For example, children, I will take one disc, 1 rupee coin, which is an obstacle. It will not enter the light. And I will take slit. From this light is coming, children. And this is screen. Generally, what we can expect, children? As this will not allow the light, we can expect a dark region here, yes or no, like this. But actually what is happening, you know, whenever light passes through the edges, it is bending, children. It is bending. So, now this is not only the image, up to here you are getting image, children. Yes or no, children? And this light is enter into shadow region also. This is not perfectly dark. It contains dark and bright regions. Dark and bright regions. Okay, children. So, central is brighter. That is called principal maxima. And alternately, you will get dark, bright fringes. So, whenever light enters into the edges, the light is not going straight. It is bending like this or like this. And the amount of bending depends upon the wavelength of incident light, children. In generally, we can able to hear the voice of persons who are conversation in the second room. Though the doors are closed, then how, children? The sound waves have more wavelength. They can bend into the room, so we can hear. So wavelength of sound is more, so diffraction is easy to observe in the case of sound. But in the case of light, diffraction is not easy to observe. Why, children? Wavelength of light is very, very small. Yes or no? For example, if you want to see two stars, if you want to see two nearest stars, see, sometimes it appears, if you see these two points from distant, it appears as single object. Why, children? See, when you are looking at these two points, the image, the light coming from this image on your retina will fall on the image of second portion. So, these two objects produces their own diffraction patterns on the eye. So, this and this maximas will combine, it appears as single object. So, that is why we are not able to resolve. So, diffraction is a disadvantage in the case of what? Resolving power. Then how? How to go for resolution? Telescope. Right, children? So, I will give two formulas. Resolving power. Resolving power of a telescope. Right, children? The formula is there. So, RP equals to A divided by 1.22 lambda, where A is the diameter of the lens. Diameter of the objective lens. While explaining the astronomical telescope, I told already, to have good resolving power, the size of the lens should be larger. That's why, see, resolving power is directly proportional to A, and resolving power is inversely proportional to lambda. So, if two lambdas are given, RP1 by RP2 equals to lambda 2 by lambda 1. Right, children? Now, see here. Here our eye is there. Our eye. Here two points are there. Our eye makes angles at two objects. Here one, this is object one, and this is what children? Object two. So this is the linear separation, and this is the distance. Right, children? Generally, if you are observing night time, a jeep or car with two headlights, if you see from distance, it appears a single bulb. When the car comes towards us, it separates the two bulbs. Same concept here. So this is resolution, children. Limit of resolution, okay, theta. So here theta equals to d by d. Okay, children, what is this limit of resolution? Means if the angle between the two objects is less than this, we cannot appear as a separation, remember. Understand? So if you want here limit of resolution in this, you should know the words, children. Limit of resolution is equals to 1 by resolving power. Remember, if the distance is less also, you are able to see, means what? Your resolving power is more. Understand? So inversely proportional. So here, so this is a theta. 1 by RP means reverse it. 1.22 lambda by d a. Yes or no? Equate these two. 1.22 lambda by a. So d by d equals to 1.22 lambda by a. Remember it. Very, very useful formula, children. Okay, na? So what you have to remember here, children, to have a better resolving power, this resolving power is directly proportional to diameter of the objective lens, or our pupil diameter should be. If it is large, our pupil diameter, you have greater resolving power. Okay, children. The remaining, I will send notes evening, children. Practice that. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Starting, sir. 11:30 work. Good morning, students. Welcome to chemistry class. In today's class, we are discussing about polymers.
all of you please follow what I sent the worksheet yesterday. So bit number 1, polymer formation from monomers. Start by, see here, the polymers formed from the monomers by 3 ways. One is free radical mechanism, and second is addition reactions, and third one is condensation reactions. See the options: hydrolysis of monomer, conversion of monomers to monomer ions by protons, condensation reactions between monomers, coordination reactions between monomers. Third option is the right option. So the polymers always formed from the monomers by the free radical reactions or addition reaction or condensation reaction. So based on the options, third option. So bit number 1, third option is the right option. Next, bit number 2, make out the most unlike form of polymerization of CH2 double bond CH, CH double bond CH2. See here, what they given? 1,3 butadiene. What they given? 1,3 butadiene. See here, in the 1,3 butadiene, these two hydrogens we call as vinyl hydrogens. So in 1,3 butadiene, the vinyl hydrogens are cannot participate in the polymerization. So see the fourth option. In the fourth option, this shows participation of vinyl hydrogens in the polymerization. So fourth option is the wrong option, and it is right for the given bit. Next, bit number 3. Here they get one polymer. Is a polymer having monomeric units. So first we will take the what they given polymer. They give the CH2, C, CH3, CH3, CH2C, CH3, CH3, taken n times. So this is the polymer. So they are asking about which of the following monomer units can give this polymer. So we will check one by one. See the first option. What they given first option? This is bond and structure. If you write the ordinary structure, CH2 double bond C, CH3 and CH3. So take the n molecules of this compound. What is the name of the compound? 2-methyl, 1-propene. So n molecule of this compound, this monomer undergoes polymerization. It can form the So this is the polymer of first option. What they given monomer? Check it with the question. So both are matched. So first option is the right option. So the given polymer is monomer of 2-methyl, 1-propene. Next, bit number 4. Regarding cross-linked or network polymers, which of the following statement is incorrect? Examples are bakelite and melamine. They are formed from bi- and trifunctional monomers. They contain covalent bonds between various linear polymer chains. They contain strong covalent bonds in their polymer chains. So actually, the cross-linked polymers or network chain polymers are formed by the monomers containing two or more bifunctional groups.
Covalent bonds. So due to presence of strong covalent bonds, the cross-linked network polymers are hard in nature. So, fourth option is the wrong option. Next. Okay. So, the cross-linked polymers or network polymers are formed by the bifunctional or trifunctional groups. And examples of cross-linked or network polymers, bakelite and melamine, both are examples of the cross-linked polymers. And for, see, the contain covalent bonds between various linear polymer chains. So, statement option A, option B, option C. All are correct about the given statement, but option 4 is wrong. Okay. Next, bit number 5. Cellulose ester is an example of semi-synthetic polymer. Cellulose ester is an example of a semi-synthetic polymer. And one more example is rayon. So rayon and cellulose ester, both are examples of semi-synthetic polymers. So bit number 5, second option. Next, bit number 6. Three-dimensional molecules with cross-linked are formed in the case of thermoplastic, thermosetting plastic, both A and B, none of these. Actually, three-dimensional cross-linked polymers is best example for thermosetting plastic polymers. So, second option. Next, pick number 7. Which of the following is a chain growth polymer? So, they ask me about the chain growth polymer. Option starch, nucleic acid, polystyrene and protein. See here, polystyrene is the right example for pick number 7. So, I will show the mechanism, formation of polystyrene. The polystyrene formed from the styrene. What is the form of styrene? CH2, CH, C6H5. This is we call as a styrene. So, let me take the N molecules. So, these are parts from the addition polymerization. Which polymerization? Addition polymerization and form the polystyrene. So this is, so pick number 7, third option, right option. So it is the example for chain growth polymerization. Next, pick number 8, Teflon, PVC and neoprene. What is Teflon, PVC and neoprene? All are copolymers, condensation polymers, homopolymers, monomers. We will see. Teflon. Teflon is the polymer of tetrafluoroethylene. So, CF2, number 1 CF2. We call as tetrafluoroethylene. So, when tetrafluoroethylene undergoes polymerization, it can form the Teflon. Can form the Teflon. This is the option. So here Teflon is the homopolymer of tetrafluoroethylene.
Lock system, sir.
Screen lock.
Ante sir, ante. Ante vasti.
Lock
again. So Teflon is a homopolymer of tetrafluoroethylene. Next, PVC. PVC means polyvinyl chloride. So, let me take vinyl chloride, CH2CHCl. We call as vinyl chloride. So, these vinyl chloride, N molecules of vinyl chloride, undergoes polymerization, they can form the polyvinyl or PVC. Polyvinyl or PVC. So, polyvinyl chloride also homopolymer of vinyl chloride. And next is third one, neoprene. Take the screenshot. So neoprene is the polymer of chloroprene. Neoprene is the polymer of chloroprene. Here and one more compound is given, that is neoprene. Neoprene is the polymer of chloroprene. So chloroprene or 2-chloro, 1,3-butadiene, both are same. So let me take the chloroprene. CH2-1C, Cl, CH2-1CH2. We call it as a chloroprene. So when N molecules of chloroprene undergoes polymerization, form the neoprene. CH2, C, double bond, C, H, CH2. Take it. So, we call as a neoprene. Now, Teflon, polyvinyl chloride and neoprene, all are the homopolymers. So, which option is the right option? Third option. So, bit number 8, third option is the right option. Next, bit number 9. Teflon polymer is formed by the polymerization of. Teflon polymer is formed by the polymerization of. First option. What they given? CH2 double bond CHCl. That is, we call as vinyl cyanide. So, vinyl cyanide can form the acrylate or olefin on the polymerization. And second one, Cl2C double bond CH2. Third one, CF2 double bond CF2. See here, tetrafluoroethylene undergoes polarization from the teflon. So what is the right option? Bit number 9, third option is the right option. So teflon is the polymer of tetrafluoroethylene. Third option. Tetrafluoroethylene. Next, bit number 10. The process involving heating of rubber with sulfur is called as vulcanization of rubber. So, if natural rubber is heating with 1-3% of sulfur, we get the soft rubber. And if the natural rubber is mixed with 3-10% of sulfur, we get the hard rubber on vulcanization. So, vulcanization. Second option, the right option. Bit number 10. Next, bit number 11. Which of the following organic compounds polymerizes to form the polyester decron? So we need to get the decron. So the decron is a polymer of, or the decron consists of monomers. What is one is terephthalic acid and second is ethylene glycol. See here, I will show the formation of decron. Decron. It is a combination of N molecules of ethylene glycol. So, we call as it is ethylene glycol. Ethylene glycol. So, these ethylene glycol react with N molecules of terephthalic acid. N molecules of terephthalic acid. So, we call as this is terephthalic acid. Both are undergoes polymerization. See here hydrogen and here OH passing away in the form of water. So, I mean, the decron is formed by the condensation polymerization. So, here we condense the water molecule. Resulting, you get terephthalic acid, ethylene glycol, third option. Bit number 11, third option is the right option. Next. Next, bit number 12. This is bit number 12. Natural rubber has all transconfiguration, alternate cis and transconfiguration, random cis and transconfiguration, all cis configuration. See here, the natural rubber can be prepared from the 1, it can be prepared from the cis isoprene. So, the natural rubber consists of all cis configuration. So, if you are in doubt, I will do the structure. Natural rubber. So, this is a structure of natural rubber. Here, all molecules, I mean, all monomers are cis forms. So, we call it as cis configuration. So, natural rubber consists of all cis configuration. So, bit number 4, fourth option, right option. Next, bit number 13. Which of the monomer of neoprene is in the following? Neoprene. For neoprene, what is the monomer? Chloroprene. So, what you have? CH2 double bond C, single bond here, CH, CH2. If you observe that, second option, right option. So, bit number 13, second option. Next, bit number 14. Which of the following is used to make non-stick cookware? See here, generally, the non-stick cookware items prepared by the Teflon. What is Teflon? Teflon means Teflon is the polymer of tetrafluoroethylene. So this is also PVC, polyvinyl chloride, polystyrene, polyethylene, polytetrafluoroethylene. So which option is the right option? Fourth option. Bit number 15. Bit number 15. The catalyst used in the manufacturing of polyethylene by Ziegler-Natta method. So here, Ziegler-Natta catalyst is a mixture of triethyl aluminum, and tetrachlorotitanium. So see here, ethylene undergoes polymerization in presence of Ziegler-Natta catalyst. From the polyethylene. See here, the catalyst of combination of TiCl4 and C2H5 taken 3 years. So, Ziegler-Natta catalyst is a combination of tetrachlorotitanium and triethyl aluminum. So, bit number 15. First option is right option. Next, bit number 16. Which of the following is an additional polymer? Bunyl S, Bakelite, Nylon 6, Melamine. So we will see one by one. First one is Bunyl S. First option is given as Bunyl S. So Bunyl S is a combination of 1,3 butadiene and styrene. So what are the monomers for Bunyl S? 1,3 butadiene and styrene. So N molecules are now, N molecules of 1,3 butadiene undergoes polymerization with the N molecules of styrene. Both undergoes polymerization, they can form a bunyl. See here, CH2, CH double bond CH. CH2, CH2, CH, CH6, CH2. So this is we call as Bunyl S. That's it. So bit number 16. First option here, 1,3 butadiene and styrene both are undergoes addition polymerization. So we will check remaining options also. Next, Bakelite, second option. Take the screenshot. So the second option, Bakelite. Bit number 16, second option, Bakelite. So Bakelite is a condensation polymer of monomers. Here Bakelite consists of two monomers, one is phenol and second is ester formaldehyde or methanol. So in the Bakelite, what are the monomers? One is phenol and second is formaldehyde. So both phenol and formaldehyde, both phenol and formaldehyde undergoes condensation, loss of water molecule and form the Bakelite. So this is Bakelite. So it's a condensation polymer. Here we condense the water molecule. So third option. What is the third option? Nylon 6. Nylon 6 is a homopolymer and condensation polymer of caprolactam. So caprolactam means NH 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This is the structure of caprolactam. So when it is undergoes, N molecules of caprolactam undergoes polymerization, loss the N molecules of water, See here, here the bond will be broken. You get NH, CH taken from C double bond. Taken. So, what are the name of the compound? Nylamosis. That's the nylamosis. And for, see the fourth option? What they given? Fourth option is melamine. So, melamine is the condensation polymer of melamine and formaldehyde. So, first I will take the structure of melamine. So, this is the structure of melamine. So, when N molecules of melamine undergoes polymerization with N molecules of formaldehyde or methanol, both are undergoes condensation polymerization from the melamine. Which one of the following structures represents nylon 6,6 polymer? Generally, nylon 6,6 polymer, which is prepared from the mixture of two monomers. One is adipic acid and second is hexamethylenediamine. Both monomers are undergoes condensation polymerization from the nylon 6,6. So, first I take the adipic acid and molecules of adipic acid. Molecules of adipic acid react with the molecules of hexamethylenediamine undergoes condensation, last the molecules of water and form the nylon 6,6. This is nylon 6,6. That's it. So compare the structure. Fourth option can be matched. So fourth option is right. Next bit number 18. So the bit number 18. The monomer of bunas rubber is bunas. Now let me discuss it. Bit number 16, first option. Bunas is combination of which type of monomers? Styrene and 1,3 butadiene. So third option, bit number 18 is third option, third option. Next bit number 19. Interparticle forces present in nylon 6,6 are actually the nylon 6,6 having intermolecular forces, those are held by the hydrogen bond. So hydrogen bonding are the intermolecular forces in the nylon 6,6. So 19, third option. Next bit number 20. Which factor impact crystalline nature to a polymer like nylon? Hydrogen bonding, covalent bonding, ionic bonding, all of this. See here, due to intermolecular forces like hydrogen bonding present in the polymers, those are strong in nature and exhibit the crystalline nature. So, for bit number 20, first option, hydrogen bonding. Due to hydrogen bonding, so the strong intermolecular forces. And so we have like our questions. So bit number 21. Next. For the formation of terylene, the number of moles of ethylene glycol required per mole of terephthalic acid is. See here, terephthalic acid. In previous bits, we discussed about the peripatric acid. N moles of peripatric acid react with the N moles of ethylene glycol. So 1:1 ratio is required. Bit number 21, first option. If you have any doubt, just go for the previous bits what we discussed. There we discussed about formation of decron or terylene. Both are same mix, decron or terylene. So when terylene is a polymer of ethylene glycol and one more terephthalic acid, both are undergoes condensation polymerization, we get the terylene or decron. Bit number 22. Nylon is an example of polysaccharide, polyamide, polythene, polyester. Here nylon means you can take a nylon 6. This is nylon 6 or nylon 6,6. If you have put both are there, nylon 6 or nylon 6,6, both are consist of amide group. CO double bond. So both are, we can say, polyamides. So nylon 6 and nylon 6,6 are the polyamides due to presence of NHCO bond. Polyamides. So which option is the right option? Bit number 22. Second option. Next, bit number 23. Gliptal polymer is obtained from the glycol by reacting with malonic acid, phthalic acid, malic acid, terephthalic acid. See here, gliptal and decron, both are formed by the, both are similar type of polymers, but for terylene or decron, we take the terephthalic acid, for gliptal, we take the phthalic acid. Take the screen, sir. I will explain 23. See here, gliptal is a polymer of ethylene glycol. Ethylene glycol and phthalic acid. So N molecules of ethylene glycol react with N molecules of phthalic acid, both are undergoes polymerization, form the gliptal. This is the structure of gliptal. So bit number 23, which option is the right option? Second option. Next, bit number 24. So the bit number 24. Thermosetting polymers. Backlight is formed by the reaction of phenol with. Now at bit number 16 we discussed about backlight. So backlight is a polymer of formaldehyde and phenol. So which option is the right option? Third option. So bit number 24, third option is the right option. What is the third option? Formaldehyde. Next, bit number 25. Of the following, which one is classified as a polyester polymer? Backlight, melamine, nylon 6,6, terylene. See here, terylene and gliptal both are examples for polyesters. Why? Because, see here, they consist of COO group. So, terylene and gliptal. 25, fourth option. Terylene and gliptal also. Gliptal or polyesters. Next, bit number 26. Which one of the following is not condensation polymer? Melamine, Gliptol, Decron, Neoprene. So previously we discussed each and everything. Melamine, Gliptol and Decron, all are the condensation polymer and Neoprene is the adhesion polymer. So which option is the right option? Fourth option. 26-4. Next 27. Which of the following represent the example of FOMO polymer? PMMA, nylon 6,6, Decron, backlight. So I will come from fourth option to first option. Fourth option, backlight. Backlight is the polymer of the formaldehyde phenol. Third option, Decron. Decron or terylene, both are same. So Decron or terylene is the polymer of ethylene glycol and terylene acetic acid. Then second option, nylon 6,6. Nylon 6,6 is the polymer of adipic acid and hexamethylene diamine. And first option, melamine. So melamine is the first option, PMMA. What is meant by PMMA? Polymethylmethacrylene. What is polymethylmethacrylene? It's a adhesion polymer. Why? Because it has a double bond, carbon carbon bond. So which option is the right option? 27, first option. First option. Next bit number 28. Which one of the following is an example of thermosetting polymer? See here 1, 2, 3. All are indication of thermoplastic polymers. And fourth one is a thermosetting polymer. The fourth one is indication of Novolac. So Novolac is the polymer of homopolymer of ortho-hydroxybenzoyl alcohol. Ortho-hydroxybenzoyl alcohol. When ortho-hydroxybenzoyl alcohol undergoes condensation, it can form a Novolac. Novolac is the best example for thermosetting polymer. So bit number 28. So Novolac. It is formed by the ortho-hydroxybenzoyl alcohol. So ortho-hydroxy. Benzyl alcohol. So when N molecules of ortho hydroxy benzyl alcohol undergoes condensation, last the N molecules of water form a Novolac. So this is the Novolac. That's it. It is example of thermosetting polymer. So 28, fourth option. 29. So bit number 29. Which of the following polymers can have a strong intermolecular forces? See here, strong intermolecular forces means hydrogen bonding. So if you want to explain about the hydrogen bonding, the polymer must be consist of high electronic atoms like oxygen, fluorine, and nitrogen. Now we will check one by one. First option, nylon. Nylon means nylon 6 or nylon 6,6. Both are consist of amide groups. So nylon exhibits strong intermolecular forces. Second one, polystyrene. So polystyrene doesn't exhibit the strong intermolecular forces. Why? Because it doesn't consist of strong electrolyte. Next, third one, rubber. Rubber also doesn't have any strong intermolecular forces. Why? Because rubber also doesn't consist of high electrolyte elements. And fourth one, polyesters. Polyesters consist of oxygen atoms. So nylon and polyester can form the strong intermolecular forces. I mean strong hydrogen bonds. Okay. So bit number 29, first option. Nylon and polyester forms hydrogen bonds. So those are strong intermolecular forces. Next bit number 30. Copolymer is nylon 6,6, nylon 6, PMMA, polyethylene. First option, right option, nylon 6,6. They ask me about copolymer. Copolymer means the polymer formed by the different monomers. Nylon 6,6 prepared from the adipic acid and hexamethylene diamine. So both are different monomers. So first option is right option. Next, bit number 31. Bit number 31. Among cellulose, polyvinyl chloride, nylon and natural rubber, the polymer in which the intermolecular force of attraction is weakest. Cellulose consists of oxygen atoms, definitely from the hydrogen bonds. Polyvinyl chloride. So polyvinyl chloride is an example for thermoplastic. So doesn't have strong intermolecular forces, maybe some strong. Next, nylon and natural rubber. Nylon having both the nitrogen atom and oxygen atom form strong intermolecular hydrogen bonds. So natural rubber is the having a weak intermolecular force of attractions. 31D. Next, 32. Which of these is not monomers for a high molecular mass of silicon polymer? So, high molecular mass of silicon polymer means it must have more number of, infinite number of monomers. But when you see the option, see the second option, Me3SiCl, it can form only dimer. We will get in the silicates, silicones of 40 group elements. When you are discussing about silicones of 40 group elements, so you get this formula, Me3Si. Me3SiCl can form dimer. We learn there. If you have any doubt, please refer the silicones one. So bit number 32, second option is the right option. Next, bit number 33. Which of the following is a biodegradable polymer? Cellulose, polythene, polyvinyl chloride, nylon 6. Polythene, polyvinyl chloride and nylon 6 are the man-made polymers. Those are not biodegradable polymers, but cellulose is the biodegradable polymer. Bit number 33, first option. Next, bit number 34. So take the screenshot once. Which of the following monomers form biodegradable polymers? So they get the pairings. First option, 3-hydroxypentoic acid, 3-hydroxypentoic acid. Second one, glycine and aminocaproic acid. Third one, glycine, sorry, ethylene glycol and phthalic acid. Fourth one, caprolactam. So we will check one by one. Actually, both first option and second option. This is the first option, 3-hydroxypentoic acid and 3-hydroxypentoic acid. Both are can form the biodegradable polymer, that is PHB, poly beta hydroxy butyrate, co beta hydroxy valerate. That is the biodegradable polymer. And second one, glycine and aminocaproic acid can form the nylon 2 comma nylon 6 polymer. It is also biodegradable polymer. So see the one by one. 34. First one. What they get first one? 3-hydroxybutyric acid. So this is 3-hydroxybutyric acid. 3-hydroxybutyric acid and n molecules of 3-hydroxybutyric acid react with n molecules of 3-hydroxypentoic acid. H2N CH2 taken from COH. Sorry. molecules need some gap. See here, take the N molecules of lysine, react with the N molecules of aminocaproic acid. Caproic acid, both are under post condensation, last the N molecules of water, form the nylon 2 nylon 6 poly. Thank you.